You and I live in a sexualized culture, okay? You know that, I know that. Maybe you don't know that, though. Maybe you've been told that by your parents, but you don't really know that because it's all around us. Maybe it's kind of like that baby fish who said to her mom, "Where's this ocean everyone's talking about?" It's simply all around us. Now, if you think I'm over-exaggerating, I want to give you two examples that I saw recently. I was in the supermarket and I saw Cosmopolitan magazine and they had a little article front cover and it said, "What guys really think about your hair and makeup? Secrets revealed." Well, I didn't open it because if I did, I would have had to go home and bathe my eyes in hand sanitizer. But I thought to myself, what is the mystery? What guys really... Okay, ladies, I didn't read the article, but just let me get it. Let me tell you. If you're wondering, let me tell you. What the guys here thought about your hair and makeup tonight, right? Not much. Just nothing, really, you know? It's like, and suppose they did. Suppose they all went to the little boys' room and spoke about their secrets about your hair. Since when did you start taking makeup advice from a teenage boy? You know, but this is the kind of stuff that we're told. And it's not just Cosmopolitan magazine that's cranking out this stuff. 17 magazine. I saw this the other day. They had an article on how you know if you are ready for sex. Okay, so let's see what the wisdom of 17 magazine has to say. Well, one of the ways you're not ready for sex, okay, ladies, so because it was addressed to you, if you are afraid that he might leave you afterwards, you're not ready for sex. Okay. That would mean me as a married man am not ready for sex because I'm not ready for my wife to leave me. But if you're a prostitute, well, that's kind of part of the deal. This is the kind of stuff that we're told, right? But I think, even though we live in a sexualized culture, I'm not saying that sex is the problem. In fact, I think that the solution to this overly sexualized culture is to think about sex more. That's right, the Australian just told you to do that. We need to think about sex more. Apologist Frank Sheed once said, "Modern man practically never thinks about sex." Now, what did he mean? You might be thinking, well, he's never met me, but listen, what did he mean? He thinks, well, look, we dream about it, we joke about it, we write songs about it, we might graffiti about it, but how many of us actually sit back and think about it? Like, what is it? What's its purpose? Do we forget who invented sex? I think most of our culture is under the illusion that perhaps Hugh Hefner of Playboy magazine created sex, you know? Maybe he was sitting around in his silk pajamas one day, puffing on his pipe and conjuring up ways to become unimaginably rich. No, wasn't Playboy, wasn't Cosmo. They didn't invent sex, they interfered with it. Who is it? Check it out. The very first commandment from God to humanity in the Bible. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. You ready? The very first commandment from God to humanity. Be fruitful and multiply and fill the face of the earth. Now, when he said be fruitful, he did not mean grow oranges. And when he said multiply, he did not mean invent calculators, right? No! He meant have sex, have babies, this is good. So sex is a good thing, it is a sacred thing, but it's not sacred like your grandmother's urn, you know, which you can't go 10 feet within, you know? But it is, it's good and it's sacred and we need to know that. And I think the reason our culture is so obsessed with sex is because it is starved for love. So often we're told that love and sex mean the same thing. And you are no different. You and I have been created by love. So we desire to be loved. We desire to love. And there is not one person in this room who can say to me tonight, "You know what, Matt? I'm different. Don't try and box me in, okay?" No, not me. I want to be rejected, used, discarded, objectified for my entire life. In fact, my goal is to be a single person with 100 cats living in a one-bedroom apartment with no friends. No! We desire to be loved. And look, to prove this to you, to prove that our culture is starved for love, check this out. Match.com. Match.com is the number one dating website on the internet. I did a little research. Apparently, Match.com has 27 million subscribers to their website. Because we're starved for love. Okay, but what is love? What is love? Right? We need to talk about what is love. Because look, I'm going to get a little crazy here. We talk about love all the time. Dude, I do. I'm like, I love my wife. And dude, I love sushi. good, but okay, you know? I mean, I'm like, I love Jesus and I love Netflix. It's like, well, what do we mean? Well, before I give you the definition of love, I thought what I would do is give you four definitions that young children had to say when they were asked the question, what is love, okay? So the first answer comes from a girl. She was age 7, and when she was asked, what is love, she said this. You know you love someone because your eyelashes go up and down and little stars come out of you. Yes, that's good. All right. The next girl, who was also 7, said, love is when you tell a boy you like his shirt and then he wears it every day. Mm-hmm. Isn't that beautiful? Now, what I want you to notice is those first two quotes are for young girls. The next two quotes are from young boys. Let's see the difference. All right, so a boy age 5 said this. Love is when a girl puts on perfume and a boy puts on aftershave and then they go out and smell each other. All right, good. But my all-time favorite is from a boy who was 6 years old, and this is what he had to say. He said, love is when mummy sees daddy on the toilet and she doesn't think it's gross. I think we need to give them some credit. I think they're doing a good job. But what is love? What is it? Let's break it down. For love to exist, there must be three things. There must be the one who loves, the one who is loved, and the love that they share. There must be the lover, right, the one who loves, the beloved, the one who is loved, and the love that they share. If you lack one of these things, you don't have love, all right? If you have the lover without the beloved, that's stalking. Cut it out, okay? If you have the beloved but not the lover, that's fantasy. It's not love. It needs all three things. Okay, check it out. If you could sum up God in one word, what would you say? God is loving. I'm sure there's a number of things that would be fine to say, but God is, what's a biblical way of saying this? Give you a hint. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, and chapter 4, verse 16. God is love. Yeah. St. John tells us twice in the same chapter. He doesn't say God is loving, although he is. He doesn't say God is lovely, although he is. He doesn't say God is lovable, although he is. He says God is love. Okay, well, if love to exist needs three things, well, what is God? God from all eternity is Trinity. The Father from all eternity has loved the Son. The Son from all eternity has received that love perfectly and given it back to the Father. That love is so powerful and so profound that it is another person. It's the Holy Spirit. Shed some new light, doesn't it, on what it means to be created in the image and likeness of God. You know, I used to think it meant God had an Australian accent. No, you know, this is what it means. Now, I want to show you something. I show you a beautiful photo of my wife. There's my wife. Her name's Cameron. She's beautiful, okay? Now, look, check this out, man. This is what I mean. When a husband and wife get together on their wedding night, think about this. How do we reflect the life of God? The husband gives himself to the wife. That woman receives that love perfectly, and in her receptivity, she gives back to her husband. And that love is powerful. It's profound. It always overflows. But sometimes 9 months later, you need to give it a name. Okay? So that is the name. That's Liam and Avila, all right? So that's my 4-year-old on the left, Liam. Looks like Bilbo, right, from Lord of the Rings. That's Avila on the right. Love her. And that's our dog, Ginger. Okay, so she never poops. She's terrific. All right. And by the way, this is my new daughter, Kiara. Isn't she beautiful? There's that estrogen again. But think about that, man. It's like, there is my baby, beautiful Kiara. Isn't she wonderful? That is the love of Cameron and I with legs hanging off of it. All right. So this is love. This is beautiful. But growing up, I was never told about this beautiful plan that God had for my love life, that he had this plan that would satisfy those desires, like those genuine yearnings for intimacy, for love. I was never told that. I think, like a lot of us, I was left to sort of put the puzzle pieces together on my own. I think I was 5 when I kind of heard my first dirty joke in the playground. I didn't know what it meant, but I kind of laughed along because I didn't want to look like an idiot. But I'm like, okay, right. Another jigsaw puzzle, if you will, I saw on a boy's toilet wall some kind of sexual graffiti. I went, oh, okay, yeah. I stumbled upon pornography when I was 8. Okay. So I'm putting these puzzle pieces together. I'm like, okay, I guess this is sex. This is love. This is what men and women do together, I guess. And unfortunately, by the time my parents sat down and gave me the birds and the bees talk, the only question I had left was, what does sex have to do with birds and bees? And they didn't know I have an answer, right? You know? I mean, no one told me about this stuff. And because no one told me, I grew up and I would just get these different messages. Now, when I was in high school, I would get these either-or statements, a lot from teachers, Hollywood, friends, okay? Hollywood would say, look, either you have sex or you end up like the 40-year-old virgin and you don't want to do that. I'm like, well, yeah, okay. I mean, if it's between those two, yeah, I want that one. My teachers would say, look, either you use contraception or you'll get pregnant or an STD. You're like, oh, okay, well, yeah, that sounds smart. You know, your friends would sort of say, well, look, if you're not having sex, what's wrong with you? You're frigid, you're prude, you're uptight. What's the matter? You're naive? Well, I don't want to be that. But no one told us that there was a third option. I remember we would go to parties and we would use this language, man. We would say, dude, I'm going to get lucky tonight, you know? Or we'd say, I'm going to hook up, you know? I'm going to get lucky. I'm going to get lucky. Did you get lucky? That's a stupid question. Think about that question. That's a question you should ask your friend if he went to Vegas for the night. You know, did you get lucky? Did the machine put out? You don't talk that way about human beings, but this is the kind of stuff that we did because no one had the guts to tell us anything else. Now, I knew that what I was doing wasn't right at these parties. I knew it wasn't right. Even though no one really had the guts to tell me that there was this third option, this love that would satisfy, I knew it wasn't right. I would come home from parties. I felt bad about what I did with this girl or that girl, you know. But I would make excuses. I would say stuff like, dude, everyone's doing it. It's fine. Okay, let's just think about that for a second. Everyone's doing it. It's fine. Okay, first of all, even if that was the case, that the majority of high school teenagers were having sex, it's not really a good reason to do it. I mean, do you remember when you were young and your mum probably said to you, now, if everyone else jumped off a cliff, would you do it? And you didn't want to lose the argument, so you resorted to illogic. And you went, yes! I loved you. I hate you. You don't even know me. You know, that was a fun conversation. But look, is that the case? Is it the case that everyone's doing it? Check this out. In my hand, I have the most up-to-date statistics on the teenage sexual activity rates in the United States where I live. This is hot off the press from October 2011, and it was put out by the U.S. Government Center for Disease Control. Okay, let's see what they had to say. The Center for Disease Control has been charting the sexual activity rates of high school teenagers from 15 to 19 years old, okay, from 1988 until now. Here's what they found out. In 1988, 49% of girls were virgins. And what about the boys? Only 40% of these guys were virgins. So that meant 51% of girls were sexually active in 1988. And what about the guys? 60% of guys were sexually active. Now, that's been a long time. That was 1988. Okay, so the latest statistics came out in 2010. What do you think happened to the numbers? Well, they plummeted gradually. Surprised? Very gradually they started going down. You're like, that can't be true. As Jason Everett says, I didn't hear that on Jersey Shore. That can't be true. Well, you know, very gradually. So that today, check it out. In 2010, the statistics show that 57% of teenage girls are still virgins. What about guys? 58% of teenage guys are virgins. So that's an 8% drop for the women and an 18% drop for the guys. So the men are leading the way here. So it's simply not the case that, well, everyone's doing it. That's what I want to talk to you about today in this beautiful gift of chastity. Now, when you hear chastity, you may think of an uncomfortable belt, or you might think of abstinence, right? You might think, well, okay, it just means not doing it. And that's not chastity. We need to be really clear on that. If you came up to me after tonight's talk and you went, Matt, really nice talk, which I encourage you to say, and you said, dude, I'm abstinent, that wouldn't tell me anything about you. It would just tell me, well, you're not having sex, but it wouldn't tell me anything about you. I mean, maybe just the opportunity hasn't presented itself. It doesn't show me that you're a virtuous person. So while abstinence is about what you're not doing, chastity is a virtue. It's about what you are doing. It means that you have control over your sexuality rather than your sexuality having control over you. So it's a virtue, just like courage is a virtue, huh? So just as courage enables a man or woman to be brave at battle in the face of fear, so chastity enables us to love rightly according to the will of God. It's a beautiful thing. Now, the other thing about chastity is it's for everyone. It's not just for like the goody little two-shoes who've never made mistakes. It's for everyone. It's for all of us. And to prove to you that chastity is for everyone, I want to tell you a story about a girl called Mary. It's a true story. When Mary was 12 years old, she ran away from home. We don't know what was happening in the home because everything we know about her, we know from the diary she left. But you can imagine the kind of home life that she was dealing with, because she ran away from home at the age of 12, went to the big city and began dancing. And then she began stripping. And then she became a prostitute for, I think, the next 17 years of her life. And she said in her diary that often she wouldn't even charge the men. Because she's like, well, no, quite frankly, I just had this under this desire for it. So it wasn't like she was this helpless little victim. Well, one day she hears about this pilgrimage to the Holy Land, where they were going to be venerating a relic of the true cross of Christ. Okay? And she hears about it, and she says in her diary, she says she underwent the pilgrimage as a sort of anti-pilgrimage. Wow. How did she pay for the pilgrimage? She slept with the guys on the boat going over there. So people would pay her, and that's how she paid for it. So Mary gets to this church where they're venerating a relic of the cross of Christ. And there's this huge procession, and she's in line, and she's walking up. And as she gets to the doors at the front of the church, she suddenly cannot go in. She's cut to the heart. She's so aware of her brokenness. She's so aware of what's happened to her, what she's allowed people to do to her, what she's done to herself, that she's just kind of cut to the heart. She walks around the side of the church into the prayer garden. She sees a picture of the Blessed Mother, and she begins to weep. She knows she's not worthy. And she looks to the Blessed Mother, and she says, if I can go in there, and if I can walk up the front, if I can kiss that relic, if the Lord wants, I will give my entire life to Him. She kind of wipes her tears away. She gets back into line, and she's able to enter the church. She processes up to the front of the altar where the relic of the true cross of Christ was. And she gets on her knees and she picks it up and she kisses it. And she says in her diary that she heard the words of the Lord say to her, Mary, if you give yourself to me, I will give you the joy and the peace you have been longing for. Mary, if you give yourself to me, I will give you the joy and the peace you've been longing for. Isn't that beautiful? He didn't yell at her. You know, he didn't say, dirty, stop it, bad. He said, darling, you've been trying to drink water and you've been drinking vinegar. You know, I know what you want. How about you let Daddy satisfy that? Beautiful. Chastity is for everyone. It's for those who have made mistakes. It's for those who haven't made mistakes. How many of us haven't made mistakes? Seriously, come on. Here's what's beautiful about this story. Mary is a canonized saint of the Catholic Church. We refer to her as Saint Mary of Egypt. Saint Mary of Egypt? She's a saint. Saint Mary of Egypt, pray for us. So chastity is for everyone. Now, I remember the first time I heard about chastity, this girl gave me this CD of this guy giving a chastity talk, you know? And by this point, I was Catholic. I had, you know, stopped all the mucking around. I decided I was going to save sex till marriage. But I still didn't really know why, except that I knew God wanted it. So I was like, that's enough for me. But I still didn't understand it. She gives me this CD about this guy giving this chastity talk. I'm laying in bed, and he's saying, he's asking the question, if he says, you might get married one day. And I'm thinking, holy smokes. That is true. That would be awesome. I never thought about that before. All of a sudden, I'm thinking, this could be, maybe I've met her, you know? Maybe she lives somewhere else. And he says, okay, now, if you get married one day, chances are the girl, you know, she it's obviously, she's probably been born. It would be a little creepy if I married someone who was little. You know, so okay. And she's like, let's say that she's with a guy right now. How far is too far? How far would you want her going with him? How far would you want him going with her? And I had to think about it, and I was honest. I'm like, dude, not far. If you wear gloves, you may hold hands, sweetheart. You know what I'm saying? But think about that yourself. I mean, that's not being a prude. That's being like, dude, this is going to be the woman who kisses my kids goodnight. Or this is going to be my husband. How far is too far? Are you kidding me? Save yourself for me. And so he's asking this question. I'm like, yeah, not far. And then he turned the question back around. He said, okay, are you living by that standard? I went, no, not really. Sometimes on a good day when I've had my coffee. You know what I'm saying? And I had to start to think, dude, I got to be serious about this stuff. Chastity isn't just about not having sex. It's about the way we dress. It's about the way we dance. It's about the way we speak. It's what we choose to look at. It's the way we speak about others. I mean, it encompasses everything. It's this virtue. So I started living it. You know what's beautiful? True story. The girl who gave me that CD, I married. Isn't that beautiful? I had no idea. I'm thinking, oh my goodness. It was beautiful. God loved her. The first time I met my wife, Cameron, can I tell you about it? All right, check it out. Dude, she's beautiful. She was wearing this bright orange shirt. And on the back, it said, call me a prude, call me frigid, call me uptight, blah, blah, blah. Not blah, 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 but you know. And then down the bottom, it said, just don't call me for sex until you call me your wife. And I was like, I was like, dude, that is like, you can have respect for that. Like, that is awesome. Well, when Cameron and I began dating for the first time, dude, I was so happy, man, because we were friends, which is so good to be friends first, because you get to see how they really are, you know? You get to see the way they treat people who can do nothing for them, you know? You get to see if they gossip, if they love the Lord, you know? And we started dating, man, and we knew we're going to save this gift till our wedding night. Now, it wasn't because I didn't find her attractive. No, it was very hard sometimes, you know? I was like, okay, I really love you. How about we go play putt-putt golf immediately? Okay, let's do it, you know? I just need it, you know, it's like, let's be realistic. We didn't not have sex because we weren't attracted to each other. And we didn't not have sex because we were afraid of getting some kind of disease. No, we saved that gift because love demanded it. Now, people gave us some really bad advice. I remember this, you know, different people would say different stuff to us, you know, because they knew we were Catholic and so we were weird and blah, blah, blah. So I remember someone said, well, okay, you're obviously going to live together, right? I mean, before you get married, you guys are going to live together? I said, no. Have you checked out the statistics on this? Check this out. A study published in the American Sociological Review said that those who cohabitate, you know, shack up before they get married, have a divorce rate 80% higher, 80% higher than those who move in after the marriage. So I said, no. And he said, well, you wouldn't buy a car without test driving it first. Have you ever heard this? That's good logic. But I don't want to give myself fully to my car. It's very different. You know, it's like, dude, no, this is a woman. No, I love her. I don't want to do that. People would say, well, okay. Well, if you're not going to live together, that's fine. But obviously, like, would you at least have sex before you marry? Because, you know, you need to know you're compatible and stuff like that. And I'm like, dude, we have the rest of our lives to experience the joy of this, to find how we, you know, complement each other. But I'm like, now is the only time we have to prepare for marriage. This is it. After that, we have no time. Now think about this. When I stand up on my wedding day, when you stand up, if you're called to the sacrament of marriage, when you stand up at your wedding day, you're going to make four promises. You're going to say, I want to be free. I want our love to be free, total, faithful, and fruitful. Free, total, faithful, and fruitful. Now, if my wife and I had made love before we got married, would it be free? Would it really be a free gift? I mean, maybe, but if I can't say no to sex, if she can't say no to sex, what's her yes worth? I mean, think about an alcoholic, right? If he can't say no to his next beer, dude, he's not free. The dude needs counseling. He's not free. He's in chains. So would it have been a free gift? Probably not. Would it have been a faithful gift? Here's the thing. If I slept with my wife before my wedding night, I would have been giving her this message. I would have said, honey, I am perfectly willing to sleep with someone who is not my wife. So when we got married, why should she think that would change? I mean, I do quite a lot of traveling, you know, 9-10 days a month around the country, around the world. But she has confidence. She knows I can control myself. We've seen this, you know, free, total. What about total? Would have been a total gift. Not really, because it's like, well, I want you tonight, and we'll see how things go tomorrow, and, you know, if they don't, well, we'll break up. No, it's like, no, this is total. I want all of you. I want your children. I want your medical bills. I want their medical bills. You know, I want their college fees. I want to be a total gift, right? Free, total, faithful, fruitful. Would have it been fruitful? No, it would have been a sterile act. We would have contracepted it. We wouldn't have wanted her to get pregnant before marriage. Here's something, dude. This is tough to talk about, but this is something people would say. They're like, okay, right, so you're not going to move in together and you're not going to have sex before you're married. But look, when you get married, you're obviously going to use contraception. Right, obviously. I mean, this is the 21st century. Come on. Like, no, I'm not. And let me tell you why. Think about this. Our culture is obsessed about being green. Look at this. Look, Dasani. Look, it's a green. What's a plant bottle? I don't even know what a plant bottle is. People are making up these ridiculous things. We're all obsessed about being green. I saw a Barbie the other day, and this is what it said on a t-shirt. It said, think pink, live green. What does that even mean? You know, and that's a pretty audacious statement for a woman who's going to take 500,000 years to decompose. You know what I'm saying? But we're also obsessed about being green. Check it out. Do you know that the World Health Organization has, through the branch, the International Research Arm of Cancer, has said that the oral contraceptive pill is a class 1 carcinogen. That's a cancer-causing agent on the same level of tobacco smoke. Not making this up, all right? No, I don't want to flood my wife with these kind of hormones. Well, what about condoms? I'm like, just no, think about that. I mean, just think about the symbolism. It's like, honey, I want to give myself fully to you. Let me get my barrier method in place. Barrier method? Are you kidding? I want to give you all of me. I want to give you the desire, you know, the possibility of children, my fatherhood. But you're thinking, okay, but surely, do you really want to have 20 kids? I'm like, no, probably not. You know what I mean? No, we do want to space them in a responsible way. So what we do is we use natural family planning. Now, according to the British Medical Journal, did a study of 19,843 women using natural family planning. It's completely natural and it's based on a woman's cycle. It's how you know if you're fertile or not. And they found that natural family planning has a failure rate of under 1%, 0.2% times it fails. So it's totally, that's it. All you have to do is abstain. Based on the woman's cycle, it could be, you know, like 9 days of the month you need to abstain. But dude, can I just be real with you? It's a beautiful thing. My wife and I, dude, we'll go on a date. We'll go to Little Italy. And I had my iPhone and I played a bit of Dean Martin. When the rumba rhythm starts to play, dance with me, make me sway. Like a, no. All right. So I played that, dude, and I was like, honey, let's dance. So, man, we were dancing in the street a little bit. People looked at us like we were weird. I totally didn't care. Okay, but here's the beautiful thing. Sometimes we will come home from a date like that, and it's like, all right, you know, like we're going to make love, right? But then she'll come in, and she goes, honey, I'm fertile. Okay, now we have a decision to make. Okay, all right. So we get to talk about things. She was like, okay, well, are we ready for another child, the possibility of another child? And she might say, well, I don't think so, honey. I mean, you said, you know, like, money's not doing great right now, and I'm a little stressed out with the kids. And so we might decide to be like, okay, all right, that's fine. And we don't have sex that night. But you know what's beautiful is you learn how to love your wife in other ways. It's like, dude, all right, man, let's go watch The Office, and I'll give you a foot rub. Sweet! You know what I mean? Like, it's beautiful. It's so beautiful. Or we might be like, you know what? I think we're ready. Let's take the risk. It's so beautiful, this natural way. Okay, so I really want you to look into that. Okay, where do we go to from here? Let's put this back on if we could. That's my son, Liam Augustine, okay? Liam Augustine. I love my son. I really do love him. We will wrestle on the bed. And it's funny, man. We love it. I'll come home. He's like, Dad? I'm like, yeah. He's like, I'm going to smash you. I'm like, oh, bring it. Like, he talks smack to me. He's 4 years old. I'm like, you really? We'll go on the bed, man. I'll get him a headlock, throw him around. It's really beautiful, you know? And what we'll often do is Avila will come in and she'll want to play. And we always have to play a little softer, you know, because she gets her feelings hurt a lot. And so we're playing on the bed. And so I thought to myself, what would happen if I pretended, you know, to get his sister, like, you know, to get his sister in a headlock? What would he do, I wonder, you know? So I went up to Avila, and I got her in a pretend headlock. I went, hey, Liam, come and save your sister. No joke. He came over to me and punched me in the temple. I didn't even know the dude could punch. It really hurt, you know? I'm like, ow, all right, you know? And it was funny. I said, okay, what would happen if it was the other way around? You know, so I held down Lee and went, hey, Avila, come and get your brother. This is what she did. She came up to him and started rubbing his face. She was mothering him. She's like, and this is what she said. She said, it's okay. It's okay. Which did nothing. He wasn't okay. He was in a headlock, you know. But there is a desire in the heart of every man to be brave. There is a desire in the heart of every young boy to be a warrior. And there is a reason for that. He's going to need to be. We live in a culture that as a whole does not uphold authentic masculinity. If you don't believe me, Maxim magazine came out with an article in March 2010. On the front cover, it said how to cheat and get away with it. So if you want to cheat on your wife so her and the kids don't know, we've got a woman who's going to give you, I think it was 9 steps on how to do it. Dude, this is the kind of culture we live in. You better believe my son has to be a brave man because he's got to grow up in the middle of this. Men, as a brother, let me speak to you. Rise up. We need you, man. This country needs you. The girls sitting around here, they need you to be men. In the way you look at them, in the way you speak to them, in the way you speak about them, they need you to rise up. They need me to rise up. Let me tell you a story about a man who did rise up. When I was kind of getting into different stuff when I was about 15, I was totally a boy. I was a boy who was starting to get facial hair, but I wasn't a man yet. Well, around the other side of the globe in Texas, there was a house party going on. And at this house party, a girl, she went there. She was about 15 years old at the time. And she had way more to drink than she had expected to that night. The parents weren't home, so she's hanging out with her friends in the lounge room, and she's totally drunk. Now, at this point, this guy spots her from across the room and sees her as an easy target. And he walks up to her, and he starts laying on the moves, And I know this girl personally, and I know usually she would have punched him in the throat when he said, "Do you want to go up to the room? I'm going to go upstairs to the bedroom." I know she would have done that, but she was so out of it. She was just like, "Yeah, okay." She linked arms with him. The friend said nothing. They didn't care. And he walked her towards the stairs where they were going to go up to the bed. Now, at this point, as this guy has got his arm around this girl, a friend of this girl, his name is Chuck, he sees these two people from across the room, and he sees what's going on. And he says, "What's going on?" And the guy says, "What do you think's going on? We're going up to the bedroom." Chuck looked at him and said, "That's not going to happen." He said, "No, it's going to happen." And I don't know what Chuck did. I don't know how he said it. I don't know what came over his face. But he looked at him and said, "That's not going to happen." The guy just backed off. Apparently, he dropped her hand and just sort of backed away. He took Cameron, walked her upstairs, and laid her on that same bed. True story. He walked outside, shut the door, and laid across the threshold of that room, so that if anyone wanted to come after her, by God, they would have to go through him first. And they better pack a lunch. Do you know what I'm saying? We need you men to be like this. I need to be like this. The women in our lives need us to be like this. My daughter, Avila. This is the girl I love so much. I just want to eat sometimes. God, I love her. I love her. I love her. I love her. Do you know what my greatest fear is for Avila? It's that she's going to grow up and the dream she has right now, she's so beautiful. She always wants to wear a tutu under a dress. Even if it totally doesn't fit, she wants to do it because mum won't let her wear a tutu everywhere. I totally do because I'm cool. But sometimes she won't let her. So she has to have a tutu under a dress. So she's walking around with this like big booty, It's gonna... And she always comes out. No one's taught her how to do this, but she always comes to show me how pretty she is. And she'll sort of do this. No one teaches her how to do that, but she does it, man. And I love her. My God, you're so beautiful. I love you. Do you know what my greatest fear is for her? Is that as she grows older, that those dreams she has, like to be loved and to love. My fear is that life is going to knock her around a bit. Stuff might, God forbid, happen to her as a young girl. Or she would make choices that would lead her away from God. And that she would get to a point where she becomes cynical. Like a lot of women in our culture have become cynical. Where they say stuff like, love doesn't exist. All those fairy tales are junk anyway. That would break my heart, But let's say she had went as far away from God as she possibly could. Slept with more guys than she could count. Let's say she had abortions. Let's say she was just in this miserable state. Do you know if she came back to me and she said, "Dad, I need your help. God, I would pick that girl up. And I would take her out on a date to like Burger King, and we get the little crown again. I'd remind her she's a princess, I would scoop her up in my arms. I would love her. And I think to myself, if this is the way I love my daughter, how much, in fact, infinitely more does the Heavenly Father love you, His daughters? It doesn't matter if you believe it, it's true. It doesn't matter if you feel it, it's true. Nothing you can do about it, And that if you, regardless of where you've been, regardless of mistakes you've made in the past, regardless of how you've allowed your great hopes to maybe deflate, that if you just turn to Him and say, "Father, help me," He will scoop you up in His arms in the sacrament of confession. He won't take you to Burger King, but He will allow you to feast on His body and blood in the sacrament of the Eucharist. So much more beautiful. Ladies, know your dignity. Regardless of where you've been, know your dignity. Like Mary of Egypt. True story. This guy started dating a girl. They were both 15 years old. Now, the father did something, right? He took his daughter's phone And he texted the boyfriend, the new boyfriend, to see what he was made of. And he pretended he was his daughter. And he said, "My parents aren't home. Do you want to come around tonight? I think I'm ready." You know what he wrote back? He said, "I love you, but no, I can't do that. I have way too much respect for your dad and you. Sorry." You know what father wrote back? He went, "Congratulations, you can date my daughter." Let me ask you a question, ladies. If you're in a dating relationship right now, if it is sexually impure, if there is sexual stuff going on, take that out. Or if it's not, ask yourself this question. If you're with a guy, what would happen if you texted him and said, "I think I'm ready, come around," would he say, "Okay"? Because if he does, you dump him immediately. Tonight, over Facebook, I don't care. Ring him up. You borrow my phone. Break up with him. He's not worthy of you. All right? Okay, where to go to from here? We're going to be having the sacrament of confession tomorrow night, and I just want to encourage you with all my heart as a brother who's been there, who's done that, who's tasted the vinegar, who's threw up from it, that not to be afraid, you know, approach the sacrament of confession with great confidence, the tribunal of mercy. The only, as Mark Hart has said, a friend of mine, the only sin God cannot forgive, and you think, okay, what is it? It's the one you won't ask forgiveness for. That's it. So be bold when you approach the sacrament of confession. I want to close by telling you a true story that happened to my son and I. I was reading him a book one night. It was a new book that I bought for him, and we lay in bed, and he sucks on his sippy cup, you know, and I read him a story. And I started reading the book, and all of a sudden he started crying out in pain a little bit. You know, he's like, I'm like, "Dude, what's the matter?" I'm reading the book. I'm like, "The book's not scary. It's fine. Okay, let's just keep reading the book." And he's like, he's clearly in pain. You know, and he just keeps sucking on his sippy cup. He's like, "I'll be okay." We didn't say that because he was two. But I kept reading him the story, and I'm like, "What is the matter?" He was in pain, and every time he was in pain, he'd go to his sippy cup, and then he'd be in more pain. Okay, confession. Dad had forgotten to take out the sippy cup from 2 days ago, filled with milk. Don't you judge me. You don't even know the first thing about me. Yeah. Dude, I couldn't believe it, man. I thought this was a new fresh sippy cup. He's drinking sour milk, the poor boy. Do you know what I did when I found out he was sucking? See, what he was doing, he was like in pain, and all he knew to pacify himself was to suck on the milk again. So it was like a never-ending cycle, you know? Do you know what I did when I found out he was sucking drink dirty milk? I was like, "How dare you, you disgusting boy." Nope. Nope. No. I said, "Honey, oh my God, I'm so sorry. Don't tell your mother." "Okay, give me the sippy cup." I walked into the kitchen. "What are you doing, honey?" "Nothing. Shut up. It's fine." Okay. I rinsed out the dirty sippy cup with boiling water, got him a new one, filled it up with fresh milk, brought it back, and he was fine. Maybe up until this point, to some degree, dude, you have been sucking on the sour, curdled love. You know, and it hurts, man. Maybe you hook up and it hurts and you don't know what else to do, so you just go back, and it's this never-ending cycle. It's like you're dying of thirst, and if there's only vinegar, dude, I'll just try and drink it, but you keep getting thirsty and it never works. But the beautiful thing is you have a Heavenly Father. I have a Heavenly Father who loves you, who doesn't condemn you, doesn't yell at you, who says, "I know what you want. Give yourself to me, and then I will give you the peace and the joy you have been seeking." Let's close in a prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you and I love you. I thank you for these young men and women. I pray, Lord God, that you would give them the courage to be brave, to make brave choices. I pray that these young men in here would stand up, be men, be brave, be heroic. I pray that these young women in here would not be afraid to be beautiful, that they would not allow the world to tell them their fertility is a disease. Let them embrace their feminine genius. Lord, put us in touch with that deep desire we all have for love and intimacy. If we've made mistakes, Lord, give us the courage to approach you in the sacrament of confession so we can be free from it, totally free from it. Lord, we love you. We know that you desire all of us to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Bless us, Lord, this night. We offer this through the hands of the Blessed Mother as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Saint Mary of Egypt, pray for us. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. A couple of things. pure commitment cards. And this is what it says. From this day forward, regardless of the past, I promise that I will save the gift of my sexuality for marriage. I choose to glorify God with my body and seek His help to pursue a life of purity, trusting that He is never outdone in generosity. You can sign it and put the date and carry it with you. I was given a chastity talk in Penn State University. This university kid came up to me. He said, I heard a chastity talk like when I was in grade 9. He's like, I still have it in my wallet. And he pulled it out. And he was still saving himself for his future wife because of the talk he heard that day. It's never too late for any of us. So please take advantage of that out there. It has been a pleasure. Thank you.